Hey, hey, it's Tomara here. Welcome to another episode of my tutorial series about making a farm game in Unity, or as you may know it, making HayDay. In this video we will improve our map by adding scrolling and zooming. Also, I will show you how to charge the player currency because you guys asked me about this. Interested? Continue watching. Let's take a closer look at what we will be making. First of all, PanZoom. This will make our map move when a player drags a finger on the screen. We will be using touch input, so before getting to writing code, make sure you have Unity Remote set up on your mobile. For this, you need to connect your phone to your computer via USB cable. It is important to do this before opening the editor. Then, on the phone, select the Transfer Photos option. This is how it is on my phone, it might be different on yours, so keep that in mind. After this, open Unity Editor, go to Edit, Project Settings, Editor. Find the Device option under the Unity Remote header and set it to any Android device. Now you should be able to cast your game on the phone. PanZoom system will also include zooming the map and following an object when it is being placed, just like you see in HayDay. As a bonus, I included a simple focus method which will help you move the camera towards an object. By the way, if you haven't watched previous episodes of my series, I highly recommend you do so because we will build on top of them in this one. But even if you haven't, don't worry, you can easily implement this system in your own project. The second thing for this episode is territory expansions. I will explain how they work and also show how to charge the player currency. The system itself is very simple, so I won't show the full code in this video, only how to charge the player currency. Additional video on expansions and script will be available on my Patreon, as well as the PanZoom script and the project files from this episode. Now let's get to coding. PanZoom doesn't require any UI elements or prefabs, so you just have to create a script and open it in the editor. Create a field for the UI camera. It will be used to convert coordinates from screen to world. Also, create a bool move allowed and a vector 3 for touch position. In the awake method, initialize the camera. This script will be attached to the camera object, so just get a component. In the update method, detect touch by checking if input touch count is more than 0. Then check if the count is equal to 2. The code that goes there will be for zooming, so we'll fill it in later. In the else, get the touch with index 0. Write a switch for the touch phase. We'll need two cases, touch began and touch moved. When touch has begun, check if it doesn't touch the UI. For this, call event system current is pointer over game object and pass finger ID to it. If this method returns true, move is not allowed, so set the bool to false. Else, set the bool to true. After this, save the touch position converted to world coordinates. In the next phase, when the touch has moved, check if move is allowed. If yes, calculate the direction of the move. For this, subtract current position converted to world coordinates from touch position you saved. Add the direction to the camera position. Now you can go back to the editor and test if everything works. Attach PanZoom script to camera. As you can see, it does, but the problem is that the player can wander off of the map, so we will fix it next. Go back to the script. Create serialized float fields for limits. Go to the switch case when touch is moved, and if move is allowed, add this line of code. Camera transform position has to be clamped between limits. X coordinate between left limit and right, Y coordinate between upper and bottom, and leave the Z coordinate as is. Also, I added a method onDrawGizmos to show what the available area is. I'm setting the color gizmos to yellow and then drawing a mesh cube. This method accepts center coordinates, which we will calculate by finding the middle point between limits. Also, it accepts the size of the cube. You calculate it by subtracting the left limit from the right limit and bottom limit from the upper. Go to the editor and fill in the values. You'll just need to experiment and get the right values here. For example, they could be minus 20, 20, minus 10 and 10. Now we can see the area, and if we test, we can see that the player cannot scroll past these points. Next up is zooming. Create two float fields for zoom minimum and zoom maximum. Then create a method zoom which accepts a float parameter. In it, set the camera's orthographic size to the camera's current orthographic size minus the increment we passed. And of course, this has to be clamped between zoom in and zoom max. Now go to that if in the update when you check for double touch input. In it, get both touches and check if they don't overlap the UI. If they do, return. Otherwise, save the last positions of these touches. Subtract touch's delta position from its current position. Calculate the distance between these last positions. For this, subtract from touch 0, touch 1, and get the magnitude. The order doesn't matter actually because we're taking the distance. Next, calculate current distance between touches. This is similar to the previous line, but instead of the last positions, we get the current positions. Now, calculate the difference between the current distance between touches and last distance. Call the zoom method and pass the difference multiplied by 0.01 float. This is needed to make the zoom not too sensitive. Go to the editor and set the min and max values, for example, to 2 and 5. As you can see, the camera currently has size of 5. Test if everything works. Moving on to the next part, following an object in the building mode. Currently, there is no way of moving the map when we are moving a building, so we'll need to fix this. In HayDay, when an object is dragged to a certain point, the camera starts to follow it. Open the script again. First of all, create a static PanZoom field current. Initialize it in the awake method. Also, we will need to create a few extra fields. Transform of an object to follow, object bounce and previous position. Now, in the update method, before everything, write an if to check if there is an object to follow. If it is not null, save the object position in a variable. We're using the world to viewport point method on object position plus bounds maximum. This method will return a vector with coordinates between 0 and 1. 0, 0 is the bottom left and 1, 1 is top right corner. Next, check this position. If it exceeds limits, you will have to move the object. Compare each coordinate to values. I chose 0.3 and 0.7. In the if, save the position of an object converted to world coordinates. We do this to make the move smoother. Now, calculate the direction by subtracting the previous position from the current position. Add this direction to the camera position and set the new previous position. In else, just save the position and set it as previous. Also, go ahead and copy the clamping code we wrote before and paste it here. After this whole if statement, return the function because we won't be doing anything else. Now, create a method to follow an object. Set the object to follow, get object bounce from its polygon collider, and also save the previous position as 0. Now, create a method unfollowObject where just set the object to follow to null. Call method followObject in building system where you instantiate a building prefab in method initializeWithBuilding. In the placeableObject script, find method place and call unfollowBuilding method on the PanZoom. And that's all you have to do. Now, go back to the editor and test how things work. As a bonus, I'm adding another method to the script called focus. If you need to move the camera towards something, that you can use this method. It's quite simple. This method accepts a vector 3 position. Create a vector 3 for the new position and initialize it by getting the coordinates from the position you passed. Get the z-coordinate from the current position because the camera has to stay on the same level. Now call the lintwin move method, pass this game object, new position and time, which is, in my case, 0.2. Clamp the position like we did before. And set the touch position to the current transform position to avoid jumpy map movement. Next up is territory expansions. As I've already said, I will explain how things work to you, but the full script walkthrough will be available on my Patreon. This system is easy to implement, so I decided to explain in this video how to charge the player currency, because some of you are having troubles doing this. First of all, let me explain how things work in territory expansions. We will have a territory object, which is essentially a bigger tile. It has its own size measured at smaller tiles, which we used for building system. We place these objects around the map to indicate closed territory. Now, remember how our building system works? It checks if tiles on our tile map are empty, and if so, the placement is possible. So the way we're closing a territory is by filling in the area under it with white tiles, which indicate that the area is not available. To do so, we get the position of the upper corner of the area, and from that point we set tiles block to taken tiles. When the player opens the territory, we just clear up the area so the building system knows that it is now available. Now let's get to the scripts, starting with currency system. First, create a method to update UI. In it, go through each currency text and set it to the amount we have in our currencies dictionary. Next, let's give the player some currency in the start method and update the UI. Now, go to the method onCurrencyChange. Write a new statement to check if the amount you pass in the event info is negative. If so, check if it is more than the amount the player has and queue an event for not enough currency and return. After this if, call the event of enough currency. Also, at the end of the method, call updateUI. I've already filled in the territory script, and here I have a button initialization which is supposed to charge player currency. Now, go to the territory script or another script that needs to be charging currency, by button and call the event system to add a listener once for an enough currency event and not enough currency event. We'll write methods for this in a minute. Next, create an event info for currency change and queue it. I also call two other methods concerning the territory. I created a method to unlock territory, which is essentially the method which will be called if the player has enough currency. Create a method on enough currency which accepts event information. Unlock territory and remove the listener for not enough currency. Create a method for not enough currency where remove a listener for the enough currency event. Now go ahead and fill in these methods. Pay attention to correspondence of methods and events. The onEnoughCurrency method goes to an enoughCurrency event, and therefore the nonEnoughCurrency method to a nonEnoughCurrency event. It works this way. An object invokes a currency change event. The currency system checks if the player has enough of the required currency and invokes the right event. Territory listens to both of these events, and in case one of them appears, it takes actions. After this, it unsubscribes the event that wasn't invoked. Now, everything is set up, we can test it in the editor. Everything works, the player is charged the crystals and gets the benefits for it. Full territory script is available on my Patreon page. Also, I'd like to thank all my patrons for supporting me and welcome new members. And that's it for this video! Thank you for watching! Don't forget to like this video if you enjoyed it and subscribe to my channel if you want to see more content like this. By the way, I'm getting to you another episode of Making HayDay this month, so stay tuned. It will be on the topic of timers. Join the Discord if you want to chat with me or other game devs. See you soon! Bye!